back in 1929, the New York stock market fell. For the next 6 or 7 years, America was in the Great Depression. Concurrent with the Depression, the farmers in New York State experienced major droughts in the years of 1932, 1933, and 1936. In stark contrast to this, there were reports of major localized flooding. This documentary is about how the Great Depression affected Christmases for many people, especially for one little girl. Ruth Myer, Nee Wilson. Her farming parents were challenged by these disasters, and the Depression brought out the thriftiness of her Scottish-Irish father and her positive-thinking English mother. This documentary came about after reading A Farm Girl in the Great Depression by Ruth Myers. I talk about this because there is a whole chapter about Christmas. What children get for Christmas was very different from what American children got in the 1930s. I have included photos, stock footage, and direct quotes from the book itself, which I really highly recommend. The book is A Farm Girl in the Great Depression by Ruth Myer.
Christmas was always a happy time at our home. If other children had more or better gifts, I never knew nor cared. There was always an orange in the toe of our bulging stockings. Other joys to be found in the stockings were lots of English walnuts in the shell and beautiful, sticky, large, tooth-cracking ribbon candy. A few other gifts, wrapped in brown grocery sacks, lay on the floor beneath the stockings. The best gifts were always in brown grocery bags tied with a red ribbon. Anyone knew that. Christmas wrapping paper was used only for relatives or grandparents. We bought very little new paper. Instead, we carefully ironed our last year's papers to pass them on to others. It was a sacrifice of time, but it saved money. Each Christmas, after the gifts were all open, a fresh supply of neatly folded papers and good ribbons was put away for the ensuing year. We'd call it recycling today. Now, this habit of ironing Christmas papers to freshen them up for a second or third gift wrapping is so deeply ingrained that I simply must iron a few papers each year. or it doesn't seem like Christmas.
Then came the star and it shone
Christmas tree and decorations were always very modest. A week or so before Christmas, Dad would go to the woods and bring back a little hemlock tree, sometimes no more than 2 feet high. Mother and I would put it on a table near the front window and decorate it with a few bulbs and tinsel. Year after year, we would beg my father to be allowed to put a string of electric lights on the tree, but he always refused because of his fear of fire. Finally, 1 year later, he gave in, but there was no money to buy lights. What could we do? Mother and I came up with a solution. At some point in the past, someone had purchased an orange-colored bulb for use in a bedroom or bathroom pail. Mother and I rigged this up with an extension cord and hung it in our tree. This was to be our sole source of tree lights for a number of years. Careful, warned Dad, don't let that bulb touch any branches. Fortunately, my mother's buoyant optimism always made the tree look great to my young eyes. It's a source of amazement to reflect back and remember how an orange bulb on a spindly, floppy little hemlock tree could spell Christmas to me. Wanted a new doll for Christmas. For several Christmases, I did get one, but then came a year when my parents were really hard up. I so wanted a new doll. On Christmas morning when I looked for one, what did I see but my last year's doll with real hair and closed eyes, all dressed up in a new silk dress trimmed in black velvet. At the realization there would not be a new doll this year, I almost started to whine. But then I caught from Mother's voice the intonations of love as she pointed out the details of the doll's dress. I sensed in a moment that this was not to be a normal Christmas. I had to return some of that love my mother had bestowed on me by being really happy. So Elle exclaimed and played with my doll all day, just as though she were a new one. Maybe I did a little growing up on that day. Such was the impression it made on me. I can, in my mind's eye, still recall the color of the dress and its design. It was made with a burnt orange silk with inch-wide black velvet trim. It was sort of a peculiar color for a doll's dress, but my mother's love made it the very best color of all.
A bleak and chill, a wintry wind, but colder far beneath. Who had the warmth of love to share with Christ the babe that Mary bare on his nativity.
was one gift I would ask for year after year and never receive. That was a book. Oh, no particular book, just a book I could call my own. All the children's books we owned were my brother's. They had been given to him, but though a little worn, were still good enough for me. Christmas was certainly not all getting gifts. I learned early to make or buy gifts for everyone in our family. In fact, all during the summer kept a running account of the amount of money I made driving on the horse fork or doing little jobs for mother. I was usually paid 5 cents a load on the horse fork. 7 loads a day would net me a little money if I could keep from spending it on candy or the movies. I needed about $2 or $2.50 for my Christmas shopping. With it, I could buy a hanky for grandmother, 25 cents, and have 50 cents apiece for gifts for my mother, father, and Dudley. We used the Sears Roebuck catalog for ordering gifts. I would spend hours studying it, trying to decide on the best gift. Unlike today, once the order was placed, you would be sure to receive your merchandise in less than a week. Once I ordered a clothes brush for my father in the design of a Scotty dog. Daddy loved dogs of all kind. I thought of it as a wonderful gift, being very high quality. On Christmas morning, when he received his gift, my father rose to the occasion and made a big fuss over that little Scotty brush. Incidentally, we were probably in the minority when it came to supplying the outhouse with suitable paper. Contrary to many people of that day and age who used the pages from a Ward's or Sears catalog as a convenient wiping paper, we used regular toilet paper in the outhouse. Mother's more genteel upbringing had a good deal to do with that, I suspect.
We'll dress the house with holly bright and sprigs of mistletoe. We'll trim the Christmas tree tonight and set the lights aglow. We'll wrap our gifts with ribbons gay and give them out on Christmas Day by everything we do and say. Our gladness we will show. We'll dress the table daintily, our finest treasures use, that all a sparkle it may be, and bright with lovely news. Then for the feasting we'll prepare a kitchen full of wondrous fare, and each from all the dishes rare, his favorite one may choose. And ye who of the price shall bring, your heart also adorn, that it may be a dwelling meet for him who now is born. Let all unlovely things give place to souls bedecked with heavenly grace, that he may view his holy face with joy on Christmas morn.
The gifts I most enjoyed giving I made myself, usually a hand-painted and drawn Christmas card. Once I sewed a little blue handkerchief for Mother. Dudley always got homemade candy that Mother and I had cooked. I loved drawing and watercoloring, and had a special delight in watercoloring very small and dainty designs. Birds, poinsettias, and holly on the cards for those I most loved. Prior to Christmas by a week or two, I would get out my paints, paper, and a picture to copy, and secretly work at the cards in my bedroom. This room was on the second floor over the living room. The pipe from the coal wood stove ran through it, and there was a tiny bit of heat in it. The room was very drafty, however. We had no storm window on, and it faced the north. I'd work at my task every night before bed until my hands got too cold to do more, or my current sore throat got worse. Finally, I'd finish the inside lettering and put the cards away until Christmas morning. I couldn't have put it into words, but I was learning that the best gift you can give is yourself.
Come, dear children, don't be dallying. All the family now is rallying. Not a moment now to spare. Joyful haste is in the air. There are nuts to crack and candies to make, and birds to stuff and cookies to bake. There's many and many a thing to do which we have done before. For Christmas, blessed Christmas, is here once more. Now begins a mighty scurrying, each to do his task is hurrying, all to finish. many a lovely memory of Christmas times of yore. For Christmas, blessed Christmas, is here once more.
These lines from a poem Ralph Waldo Emerson were a source of inspiration to my mother, and often quoted at times of difficulty. The sun will shine after every storm. There is a solution for every problem, and the soul's highest duty is to be of good cheer.